Kongu SRB International School presents the webinar conducted by Career Beacon Myths and Facts series. Webinar on how are teachers motivating the students to be efficient during the crisis as students are getting gloomy and sad minds. Here are the glimpses of ideas of the speakers. Happy to announce our very own speaker, Mrs. Subbulakshmi Bulusu, Vice President, Head of School, SRV and Kongu SRV Rasipuram, who is a believer of holistic learning, gives away a strong solution for the problem by identifying the root cause of the issues and work on it, learning to be engaging and challenging. Along with her, Ms. Aarti spoke how teachers are motivating the students to be efficient during the crisis. Mrs. Bhavna Chen added how teachers are playing a vital role in making the child efficient. Ms. Sabina Keshwani spoke on implementing interesting and innovative techniques. And finally, Ms. Nayan Chawla on engagement of students virtually and making them connected. Yes, it's time to sit back and engage our minds with fruitful ideas. Stay tuned.
Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the episode 8 of Myths and Facts series. We are back with another exciting topic and beautiful speakers, those who are coming from a veteran background, and all of you, you can see and watch in a while that who all are coming and who are all are going to speak today during this session. As you know, Career Beacon organizes few of the webinars, and this Myths and Facts series, to be very honest, it has got an overwhelming response because we are getting people, speakers from every corner of the country that they would like to, they are really liking this series and they are very happy that we are taking and debunking many of the myths on that. Just to introduce who are you going to be a host, it's Kavita and myself who are going to host you today. Career Beacon is a bi-monthly magazine and we are catering to the students, schools, administrators, teachers, parents, and it has got a print with 8,500 copies nationally circulated, and we wish to reach to the target of 50,000 as soon as possible, maybe by end of 2021. Together, myself and Kamita envisage that we would like to impact 1.3 million students by end of 2022, and that too through the career guidance activity. And to ensure, this is one of the initiative that Career Beacon, where you can see the print editions have already come and the fourth one is also into the editorial thing. Any one of you who is interested, please do write the editorials for us. Now coming back to the Myths and Facts series, as I've said that today is the 8th episode. So we have spoken to multiple speakers during these weeks. The first week when we started with the episode, it was with the IT teachers. So we have discussed about how can technology be used to deliver a better learning theories, and all the IT teachers of various schools, they have participated. In the second episode, again, we did it with the school teachers, wherein we spoke about, is it safe to send the students to the school before the vaccine hits to the market? And we have got a very beautiful review and we concluded the session on that no, it's not safe. In the third episode, we actually spoke about, because that was the time when the NEET result has come and the guy has actually scored 720 out of 720. There were people who were scoring 100% in various subjects, which we have seen in the 12th and the 10th class board exams. So there is a psychological outbreak with the college cutoff soaring to 100%. And we discussed this with educators and the principals during that session. In the fourth episode, it was a very touching topic because we wanted to speak about child abuse. What is the role of educators in preventing and responding to the child abuse? Followed by that, we actually came to a very soft corner of the thing, that whether the soft skills should be a part of the curriculum or not, wherein we had 5 speakers who spoke about these topics. Then subsequently, we raised on to another topic wherein we spoke about challenges and opportunities in the innovative learning K-12 methodology. Here we spoke to various principals and academic heads of different schools from different places so that they can discuss. Last week, we actually spoke into a different leg, that is cultivating a teacher and the student relationship with a high quality, high expectation relationship to deliver a better learning. To take this leg forward and to discuss the extended arm of the teacher-student relationship, we are actually speaking on a very sensitive topic, that is how teachers are motivating students to be efficient during this crisis time, as students are getting gloomy and sad with their minds. And to discuss this, we will have five eminent speakers who are joining us from the various corners of India, and Kavita, who is going to introduce them. I will introduce first Kavita, that what exactly she is going to do. And for those who have not been a part of the two episodes, and the ninth episode, that is the next week, would be supporting students to learn from the mistakes. And episode 10 would be that how classroom games can create a growth. If you know, you know, any of us, you would like to get in touch with us, please do come to us and register yourself as a speaker. So only 9th and 10th episode will be shooting, and after that we will be starting another exciting round of the series, but that will be you know, you'll get to know only in the 10th episode of Career Beacon. Now to come to the context back, that what exactly is Myths and Facts and what is going to happen today, let me introduce Kavita Rai. Kavita Rai is a partner with me in various initiatives like Concept Career Guidance. Then we have, the Career Beacon magazine that you have taken. She's having almost 8+ years of the corporate experience. And after that, she has been into the counseling. Now, when she is doing counseling, she is doing relationship counseling, family counseling, career counseling, everything. So far, she has impacted over 3,600 students who are actually a part of the career guidance. Plus, she has over 498 students, you know, mid-career crisis, the cases that she has handled. And all she is doing with the help of a psychometric, which is a validated psychometric. Just to inform every one of you, when we are doing a career guidance, you need to ensure you might be enrolled with the number one company in India or in the world. But just ask them whether the test is validated or not. Because if the test is not validated and if IIBP is not given any certification, then believe me, how beautiful the report is, how beautiful the company is doing, maybe the kind of branding that they are doing, that is not going to land up in the proper careers. So this is small advice from the Career Beacon to everyone. IIBP is actually certifying the things, and you can find it out on the Google that who is the certifying authority for that. Now, with this, let me introduce Kavita. Kavita has been working in this field with me together. And together, as I've said, that we are envisaging to impact the student. With this, let me welcome Kavita. Kavita, over to you. Take the question answers with the beautiful speakers that we have today.
Thank you, Sunanda. And before we move to the topic, I'd like to introduce our beautiful speakers. So I'll go alphabetically. We have with us Mrs. Aarti Dua. She is a principal, Narmada Calorix Public School, Bharuch, Gujarat. She has over 17 years of experience. She has been teaching economics. And when we asked her, like, how are you as a teacher motivating the students to be efficient during the crisis, as students are getting gloomy and sad minds? She mentioned the real point to consider are not the strict adherence to regular conditions and norms, and what we can expect during our conversation with her is utilizing resources to create a conducting environment, promoting motivation and ideation among the learners behind the cameras, because this is the new normal everybody is going through. With that, I'd like to welcome Mrs. Aarti Dua, and I'll request her to please set the context for.
Good noon, the one and all. I always love talking with Sunanda and Kavita. They keep the rolling ball moving. You know what the kind of world set up after new normal, you never know what kind of emotional balance a human face. This stage can be a little complex, a help solving complex problem, lead the human being to reactive rather than deliberative. Focusing on activities that can be done at home like gardening or crafts help control anxiety. Quarantine is, I think, a good time to learn something new or do activities that have been pending, such as practicing an instrument, finishing a book, or starting a journal. Events such as this help you feel more in control and let you make the most of your time. Working for a longer period of time, especially after encountering numerous obstacles, a small motivation by a teacher will work like a barometer for the students. I'll give you an example of my student Kavya. She's a student and she was practicing jumping rope. But she always continued trying in jumping rope during the recess also. And that is the reason behind that is a teacher's statement saying, you have just done a wonderful job. That keep her going. So this is how it works. A little motivation keep you rolling.
That's so beautiful, Aatiji. Welcome and thank you for your words. With that, our second speaker is Mrs. Bhavna Chadda. She is a French language teacher at the Mann School, Delhi. And she has over 8 years of experience. She's been teaching French and life skills. And what audience can expect is teachers play a vital role in making a child efficient during tough times by supporting them in various ways. That is on emphasizing their strengths, by supporting them in their choices and interest, and by getting their boredom over. That's a really challenging part. And the myth on motivation, she mentions, those who are emotionally strong, they are self-motivated. And we will be having a great conversation today in the entire session. I welcome Bhavna to you, and I request you to please say a few words.
Thank you, Kavita ma'am, for giving me such a lovely introduction. First of all, I would like to thank Principal Sir Mr. S. Sri Ram for giving me this opportunity. And secondly, to the Career Beacon providing me this platform. And I welcome all the eminent speakers today. Good afternoon to everyone once again. I will start with a quote said by a very famous Persian poet, Rumi. What he says in one of his poetry, out beyond the ideas of wrongdoing and right doing, there is a field, I will meet you there. I as a teacher meet you there with their children. So for today's topic, I want to set a context that the teachers really play a vital role in making their children efficient. How? By supporting them. Now, support can be of several ways. It can be emphasizing, it can be encouraging, it can be motivating. But as a today's scenario, it's really a bit difficult. Motivation was difficult in traditional classrooms also, because students very regret in listening to the teachers. But as a teacher, we always apply different strategies to do so. So today also, we are doing our best. We come out with the different ways so that students should not feel bored, they should not feel sad, they should not feel gloomy.
Thank you, Bhavna. And absolutely, that's a challenge to motivate a child. And we will be discussing with eminent speakers. So with us, we have Mrs. Naina Chaure, and she is a principal, Mount Litera Z School, Bhind, Madhya Pradesh. And she has over 25 years of experience. She's been teaching economics, English, and business management. In this crisis, teachers can motivate students, she says, by engagement of students virtually and keeping them connected through projects, competitions, celebration, and interactive seminars. And we'll get in our conversation with her guidelines for Child Connect, effective parenting, motivate a positive generation of matured adults, collaboration. With that, I welcome Ms. Naina Chaure, and I request her to please set the context for today.
Very good afternoon to all the beautiful people there. Thank you, Career and Beacon. You two young ladies have that, magnetic power of bringing together all the educationists. So I'm privileged and honored today to share the screen with all the history makers, the changing agents, my academicians, my fellow friends. So we welcome each other, and I feel that this today's day will be a unique day for unforgettable for all of us. Well, I was very attracted. Thank you, Ms. Sunanda, for giving me this opportunity personally. I really feel happy to be here today afternoon. So as a senior leader, I choose to return to the classroom where I felt I belonged. Taking the responsibility of my own development, researching, sharing latest trends and courses, I remained current, but I accepted the shortcomings. This pandemic, this corona, changed the matrix of education. They gave us a new vision of life. We all understood that how fragile we are and nothing is in our hands in front of Mother Earth. So when we as academicians come together and we teachers put the best foot forward, and the thanks to the stakeholders, the parents, the students who supported us by getting them engaged into the virtual classrooms. So how to make them effectively engaged, how to make them magnetized is all the teacher's job, I feel. So when I say that quality education is all based on relationships, and relationships is like leading with love. This generation, we have to talk about 21st century rather than education. I feel we should talk about childhood, the childhood of this 21st century kids. We should talk on that today. I'm going to talk about that. Thank you so much and all the best for today's show.
Thank you. A warm welcome to you. And with that, our fourth speaker, Mrs. Sabina Keswani. She is from APJ Education Society, Head of Schools, Mumbai. She has over 27 years of experience as an educator and over 10 years of experience as a principal and a vice principal. And she has taught literature, economics, philosophy, and maths. And she says that teachers can motivate students in this crisis by implementing interesting, innovative, and inspiring techniques of student engagement. And the myth on motivation, she says, writing your goals down is the key to success. We will be discussing this in our session today. And with that, I welcome Mrs. Sabina Keswani, and I request her to please set the context for today.
Thank you, Kavita. Thank you, Namaste, everyone. I'm feeling grateful to be a part of this discussion, these Myths and Facts, episode 8. A big thank you to Career Beacon, Sunanda ji, Kavita ji, all esteemed panelists and the viewers. I strongly believe teachers who are self-motivated and reflective will always be able to create the magnanimous magic of motivation across the schools and around the world. Such kind of teachers with their quality intervention, approach, and attitude can make a tremendous difference in students' life. It is very well said, a good teacher is like a candle. It consumes itself to light the way of others. Thank you so much. Thank you for the opportunity. Namaste, everyone.
Thank you, Sabina. It's a pleasure to have you. With that, we have an eminent speaker from Tamil Nadu, Mrs. Subbalakshmi Bulusu. She's a vice president, head of school, SRV International School, Rashipuram, Tamil Nadu. She has over 30 years of experience, 38 years of experience. She has taught English and science, and she's been teaching teachers for the past 20 years. And she says that teachers can motivate students in this crisis time by identifying the root cause of the issue and working on it. And she mentioned the myth of motivation is learning to be engaging, challenging, and relevant. So with that, I welcome Mrs. Subbalakshmi, and I request her to please set the context for today.
A very good afternoon, everybody. Thanks a lot to the Beacon team, Career Beacon team, for involving me in this session. A very good afternoon. First of all, we need to think about, this is a crisis, yes, all of us know, but why the children are gloomy, what is actually the point behind that? So the main reason what I understand is, like, kids are like, they're missing their school, that running in the corridor, that Tom and Jerry fight, and that assembly in the grouping, and their birthday celebrations in the school. These are the most important things that the kids are missing. So I think if we really think about those areas, automatically, they enjoy their learning. no child wants to like refuse to learn or something like that. Every child is interested and every child wants to be the best. But there are some things which are behind them, which are really bothering and they can't do anything for that. And the other side, I have my mother next to me in the class, which is really bothering me. You know, I never experienced this, having my mom in my class and pushing me. You answer that. Why are you not answering? You know that. You don't know that. Don't you know that? So all these kind of things really are bothering the kids. Probably if we can work out on these things, and maybe in the session we will be discussing a few of these things, I think it will be very, very good for the students and for the schools also. And whether it is normal or new normal or anything, we can really make it happen in the better way. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And I think that's what echoes with the students, what you have mentioned. And yes, we are now, technology is connecting us, but we need to connect emotionally with the child. And especially when so much anxiety and uncertainty is there at present. And it is also said by the neuroscientist that emotions are the key to learning. So we need to think about it. We need to emphasize on it and work on it. So with that, we'll move to our question and answer session. And I'd like to invite Ms. Aarti and ask her, you know, what factors influence students' motivation?
See, it depends. It depends on the age or even the mood of the child. Motivation may vary. The universal method to do this is still to paint. Since each child has his own personality, that must be taken into account. Elementary school programs are focused on new knowledge acquisition and learning process in general. First, we must understand how to improve the child's desire to learn. For example, say self-efficacy and competency perceptions. So when people accept to do well, they try hard, persist and perform better. Students who believe they can will definitely do well. They are much more likely to be motivated in terms of efforts, persistence, behavior than students who believe they are less able to succeed. Secondly, it can be a classroom environment. It is an important factor. When teachers show enthusiasm and passion for the subject that they are teaching, it can be contagious for most of the students who will model your positive behavior. Besides teaching the curriculum, be a role model to them. Reinforce positive actions to motivate students to learn. Feeling free to express themselves will encourage students to be engaged. Students who have positive relationship with the teacher are more engaged in learning. You can even have group discussions about subjects that interest them to uncover their personalities. I think next on the scale can be interactive activities. Teacher can incorporate different learning strategies, activities to enhance the learning skill and also make the learning process more attractive and interesting. We can arrange even a sharing session while students will share their personal opinions, their skills, and also make the learning process more attractive and interesting.
Thank you, Aarti. You have mentioned about the student engagement playing a key role in student motivation also. So I'd like to go to Bhavna. I'd like to ask her, how can teachers promote students' engagement and motivation to learn also?
Well, thank you, Kavita ma'am, for this question. We have, as the teachers, we have several ways to do so. First of all, engagement. The engagement of the student is very much important. Now, in today's scenarios, we are far away from the children. We have a very big gap between us. So what I do in my classes, I use the role play techniques, which are very often used in the classes to break the monotony. When we do the role play, suppose I have delivered a lecture, now I tell students to come and do it in a role play. They take interest. Whatever the lecture is, if it is boring or what, when they come to enact it, they feel happy. And once they feel happy, the engagement is there, students are happy, no boring, no sadness, nothing. So I would prefer to have role play techniques most, because I teach class 6 to 8, these are the students, those who get the most diverted, because they don't want to listen every time. They want something out of box activity actually. So if I quote one example of my class only, as I teach French, so French is a foreign language and everybody cannot understand in one go. So I have to speak and they have to listen. So to break this monotony, what I did, I am explaining the concept of how much and how many. So students are getting bored because I'm not getting the responses from their teacher. Can assume ki yes, students are not taking it seriously. So what I did, I said, let's do some role play. Let's make a scene of Shole. You all have seen the movie Shole. There is a scene, kitne aadmi the. So they all tried it to speak those things in French very easily. They tried this. Sometimes they are wrong, but their participation is there. Suddenly I saw a change. The screens are on. The students are requesting, please ma'am, make us unmute. We want to do it. And just that 10 minutes before, all are just like a sleeping beauties. So what I would say, think of the activities which are out of box, such as role play techniques. Thank you.
Thank you, Bhavna. It means the teachers need to be also creative and innovative in delivering.
Yes.
And with that, I'd like to go to Naina and ask her, is there any model or framework to highlight some of the significant factors that influence student motivation, often drawing from and demonstrating overlap among their frameworks?
Well, thank you. It's a beautiful question and put forward for me, and I'll try to justify it. Well, according to me, my perspective of teaching and being with the students is, I will like to take care of the creative side. So rather than for me going through the outdated techniques that we normally follow, we say it is the, you know, we say this is the new normal. Okay. But actually it is not new normal. According to me, it is the old normal. What we did when we were kids, we want our students to do the same. Where we go wrong? I feel we as teachers should be good listeners first. We should understand the creativity level. We are in the age when Siri and Alexa is answering them within a fraction of a second. And we belong to that age, and we expect those students to do what we want to do or what we have done. How will be the combination set? This is where the gap begins. And this is where we have to bridge the gap as educationists. I feel this is adultification, which is taking on the nerves of the students. Let's all kneel down at 3 feet and see the world from there. Let us all kneel down and see the world from the 3 feet, how they see the world. Let us not force them to do what we want them to do. And let us live life according to them. And then I feel after 5 years down the line, we get a different generation altogether, which will be faster than the computers. Let us all teach them to compete with the machines. So rather than framing something like what I did in my previous school, I had to send certain messages. So I had sent my students for role plays on the streets. Literally, they were on the roads enjoying them with the skit plays, with the role plays, and just, you know, passing on the social message. It can be anti-tobacco, it can be go green, basic thing, basic save water. But when we demonstrate it likewise, because all the students have their unique, you know, they have that creativity part, let them grow with that independence. That is what I feel. And then let us not stick to the curriculum of the 19th century. If we say we are in 21st century, we have to start living accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you, Naina. It's absolutely bang on that we are teaching Generation Z, and we cannot expect that, you know, we are the migrant to the technology. So we they are abreast us. So we need to be more creative, more, more accepting as a teacher and educator, because there are a lot of technology terms we can learn from them. So absolutely, technology is playing a lot of great role presently. Yes, it is the thing that is connecting the student and teachers and educators together, and we are also connected through technology. With that, I have a question for Sabina ji. on this only. How does ICT support the teaching, learning, and assessment?
Thank you, Kavita ji, for such a meaningful question and very well relevant in today's crisis time. Like all of a sudden, we all switched on to computer-based learning, digital learning. Though we were teaching the, you know, earlier it was involved, like we were involving technology for the higher grades or for some seminars or some conferences. And when we were having the cross-fertilization of resources, that point of time, we used to adopt technology. But if we look at the current teaching learning process, which is kind of completely into the digitalized mode, that has completely reshaped the teaching learning process. It is very interesting mode because if you plan your virtual lesson plan, certainly you can deliver so well in a systematic way, because you teach in bits and pieces, and then you come to know, you would like to know the feedback. You may have a Google form, you may have a quizzes, or you may have a survey forms, and you try to find out how much the students have learned, what is their feedback. So feedback is kind of a feed forward where, you know, you try to improvise your teaching learning process. You come to know. At the same time, you also come to know which students require handholding, which are slow learners. Sometimes you know, teachers unconsciously, they get into the mode of teaching. So much they are engrossed into it that you have to cater to a variety of learners. So when we talk about Howard Gardner's theory, or when we talk about Bloom's taxonomy, that doesn't come into in practice because unconsciously we are into the mode of teaching. But with this technology, you have planned yourself so well that you incorporate in between some kind of a fun element. So you come to know and you improvise your teaching learning process through Padlets, through Mentimeter, through Zoom boards, digital boards. You can actually utilize, you can share your screen, students can show their work. So that becomes very interactive. It can generate immense understanding. And the teaching learning with this kind of a technology has become very, very powerful too. So it has really helped students. And I guess in future also, when everything is back to normal, we need to utilize this process so that we can go ahead with the hybrid or a blended learning, so we can take the benefit of the ICT process in the teaching learning. Thank you, Kavita.
Absolutely, ma'am. When you have said, yes, there are different learners which are there. They have a different needs, different pace of learning that is there. So I like to go to Subbalakshmi ji, and I like to ask, how do you deal with a student who refuses to learn? We always have, you know, one or two students.
Okay. Yeah. First of all, I feel this is a very relevant and wonderful question. I would say that, in fact, no child wants to kind of, you know, refuse to learn. Every child wants to be, okay, I should be the good child in the class. I should be in the thoughts of my teacher. So I want to do the best. That thought is there in every child, but there is something that is bothering them behind. So more than the classroom environment, I would now take up the other abstract things which maybe most of the people are missing, or maybe most of them are doing also. But, you know, it's the first thing is like, respect the child. Most of the time we expect, okay, that the student should respect the teacher. Am I respecting the child? Am I respecting the thoughts of the child? If the child is saying something, you know, there are teachers who giggle at it if it is wrong. No, correct the child's mistake with respect. Oh, I think this is what you meant, but actually that is actually the correct one. So if we can put it in a better way, the child won't feel insulted. Once the child feels insulted in the class, whether it's virtual or physical, automatically there will be some kind of self-demotivation and will not be a part of it. And also give them the time and space for the children. Each child needs a different time and space. If you can work on it and understand that and give the time and space for the child, definitely it will work out. And of course, the universal statement of never compare and brand them. And don't let the parents to compare them also. Especially in this crisis time, they're at home. So they are really sometimes, most of the parents are, you know, having a highlight on the child and focusing on the child. And then you're not doing this, you're not doing this, you didn't answer in the class. So that's not required actually. Let's motivate the child. Appreciate the child, but correct the child with respect and all that. And build a rapport with the child. As a teacher, give an assurance okay, my ma'am is better than my mom. That is the feeling the child should get. Oh my God, it's better to go to school. Ma'ams are better than moms. Because she assures me, she gives me that confidence. She corrects my mistakes with respect. So she gives me that thought. So that thought we have to generate in children. And finally, the attitude and the enthusiasm of the teacher matters a lot to help a child not to refuse learning and to help a child enjoy the learning. So I'm sure I think that these points to be kept in mind, it will really help a child to learn much better, like the time and space, the respect and that they give it to the children, and the recognition that they give, because there are, especially in the virtual classes, most of the children, they are in the screen either with the cameras on or off, but sometimes the questions don't go to them or the compliments don't go to them. So that's the one point maybe that we have to keep in mind. And I think with these kind of things, we can help the children learn better and not to refuse their learning. Thank you.
Absolutely. We need to, you know, take them as an individual. An individual need to be respected. It has to be a teacher or it is a child. And the very lovely thing is like socio-emotional need you have touched upon, that the school and the educators are serving, you know. That's the reason, even when I was a student, we used to wait when this summer holidays will be over and I'll love to go to school, you know. We were so happy to be on the first day of the school to be in the school. So with that, I like to ask Aarti ji, you know, we talked about a student need to be respected. So my question is to you, what should we consider from the student perspective?
I think motivation is not only important for it, like in its own right. It is also important predictor of learning and achievement. Students who are more motivated to learn persist longer, produce higher quality results, and perform better in classes and on standardized tests. Our strategy is to help students discover personal connections between their lives and what they are learning. For students who have a good handle on who they are and what they are interested in, simply promoting them to reflect on connections may be enough to increase their motivation. I wanted to share my own student story who never was attentive in the class and most pampered and notorious child of the class. Very soon we realized that he even don't recall alphabets in standard fifth. Then we made him learn saying he will be taking the class if he write 5 alphabets in cursive. Immediately he took out his pencil and notebook and he did all the work in half of the period and was ready to mind the class. So like that, we have encouraged that. We have taken the child's attention from different things to the classes, to the study. So student must feel that connection with the teacher. That teacher is there for them and not for the others. If you can make that connection with the student, definitely it is very easy to boost them to sit in the class for 30 minutes and complete the work in turn. Because whole focus will be on the definitely performing better and in comparison of the others. If child feel like teacher is there for them and she is looking after her every now and then, definitely they will be performing better. And that motivation and the preferable child in the rest of the 40 definitely give you a lot of boost.
Thank you, Aarti. It's like absolutely a child need to feel that connection need to be built. But I'll move on to Bhavna and I'd like to ask her, how to deal with unexpected things then? You know, teaching when you and your students can't make it to the, obviously you have to be there for teaching, where your students can't make it to the class.
Thank you, Kavita madam, for giving me this question. And really it's a practical question. On and off we face this thing in the class.
Especially online, I feel this.
Yes, this is really, again, I would like to say ki we cannot make every class activity-based class. This is for sure. We have to do some seriousness. We have to take out some seriousness in the class. But on the same time, again, we are a teacher. We have this responsibility to make a class happen. So what I would say, students are getting bored again because there is engagement, no engagement. When no engagement is there, they definitely feel bored. And once they get bored, everything gets over. So what I say, whenever you are taking a lecture, what you you can do, prepare your lecture. If you have a 40-minute session, minimize your teaching time. Suppose 40-minute lecture, in that you can take 20 minutes for your teaching and 20 minutes for activities based on that topic only, so that the student can understand the chapter thoroughly, their engagement comes starting, they are getting involved, they are trying to explore themselves, what kind of activities we can do it. As I do, I give them to do the survey. I told them to do some quiz activities, some debates. So something like that we have to add now, because to kill this boredom, we have to do some activities one in or other way. Not a full class of activity, but minimize your teaching time. It should be 15 to 20 minutes in 40 minutes, and rest time you can based on activity, so that your class should be productive.
Absolutely, Bhavna. I believe that's, I will not say, because teachers are teaching, it's a passive learning that the kids are getting into. As that ma'am is why said, they are not able to recall it.
As ma'am said, ki, because they are not getting in connect now, so we have to make them connect. With virtual classroom, we need to make them contribute. So this is the way I feel, that we should minimize our teaching time and we should give them equal time as their interest and choices.
Right, absolutely. That's a need. We talk about, you know, different pedagogies and different strategies to make it them an active learners.
Active
the
learners.
Whole thing is making them an active learner. Active. So with that, I like to go to Naina ji, and I like to ask her, you know, this one strategy, CATS. So what are the classroom assessment techniques, that is CATS?
Well, it is going very interesting with my fellow friends. I hope all are the audience is enjoying this session. With the CAT, which itself says that it is a, you know, assessment technique. So I feel it is a simple, it is non-graded, it is anonymous in-class activities where we take the feedback, you know, of the teacher and of the student there and there. Like when we were small, we had a teacher who used to enter the class. My many teachers are watching me today. So I really loved, we didn't like actually then, but now I feel it is good. So many teachers, you know, entered the class and they took the recap. We call the recap, right? They wanted to check whether the class, notorious students, you know, were paying attention or no. So, and then they would take the recap. Well, it would be like she's asking again the old thing, but then okay, that was it. That was again an assessment whether the child was paying attention or no, indirect way it was. Then today, if you say we have the muddiest point that we call now, I call that thing, where we say which muddiest point is whatever you found in the session, I'm talking about the virtual classroom, whatever you found it is difficult, you just jot it down, whatever was difficult. Then the other technique will be like, you know, going with the, at the end of the session, you can just ask them to cover it up with the, like, just, you know, what did you take away from this session? So this will, as rightly said by my fellow friend, previous answer she gave, very nicely she has answered. She said, yes, we, not necessary we take the full session, you know, we can just keep it interactive. And according to me, if there are teachers, we don't normally have today, but then if teachers just go on teaching and if there is no feedback, there is no response, then the class will be, this is a virtual class, the class will be totally cold, you know. So there should be interaction, there should be talking, there should be fun, there should be voices, you should be listening. And I guess if you follow these techniques, then you will not get, you know, learned monsters. You will not get skilled psychopaths. You will not get the children who are just, you know, educated maniacs. You will get a new generation which is full of creativity and new ideas upcoming every time. So if we follow 21st century pedagogy, if we follow the three H's, and, you know, for teaching through the head, hand and heart, if we follow the three R's, that is reading, writing, arithmetic, if we follow the four C's, that is collaboration, communicating, creativity, critical thinking, then I think this answer is properly taken care of. And rather than assessment, we use the word give and take, because even the teachers are learning every day from the students. In fact, this pandemic taught us so many things that the students taught us many things about, as you said rightly, that we learned so many new technology ideas, and I guess this is CAT according to me.
Thank you. Absolutely, that's the need, that it has to be interactive, it has to be two-way, and we always, now it is the time we more emphasis, you have to be a lifelong learner. So teacher is also a learner, and a student is absolutely, they are also a learner.
The point I would like to add, there should be planning from the teacher's end. So if there is, until and unless there is no planning, a goal without a plan is just a wish. So I would just recommend all the teachers to plan out, sort out what you are trying to achieve. First of all, clear your vision, develop a long range target, create a picture of what X will look like after X years. I think the things will fall in place then.
So with that, I like to go to Sabina ji, and I like to ask her, why should teacher use these CAT techniques, you know? Just thank delivering you know, why this should be a part of delivering any lesson.
Yes. Thank you, Kavita ji, for such a meaningful question. You know, at times we have a meetings, you know, why to have this assessment? You know, why unnecessarily we need to bother students with the assessment? Couple of times when we review the foreign system also, like they have, you know, maybe the summative assessment is not applicable in couple of courses. And we just sometimes, you know, like bringing the across the globe techniques and strategies to understand. But if we really go to see, especially in the Indian context, if we take the assessment, we come to know that some of the students' achievement is really very good, and some of the students require handholding. Some of the students have not understood the concept very well. So maybe what kind of strategies, what kind of techniques, what kind of methodologies, pedagogic skill a teacher needs to implement? This is such a wonderful query actually in it, because what happens, the teachers then collaborate and then they spirally link up the curriculum and they try to discuss whether we have taught this particular theme properly in the grade 9 or grade 8, why students are having so much of difficulty. Maybe sometimes the chunk is 30%, sometimes 20%. So it allows teachers to collaborate, to have a cooperative learning. Second very wonderful point is with this kind of assessment, if we take in a classroom on a regular basis, whether it's a summative or a formative, it gives you understanding of where you require to incorporate design thinking, you know? Because if you imply, if you implement the design thinking, maybe you can utilizing versatile strategies, versatile methodologies in your classroom so that students can understand. So, some of the students, they develop the leadership skills because teachers utilize them as a monitored classroom so that they will teach the session. They become the peer teaching class and the peer learner. So they the students who are learning from their peers, from their friends, they get inspired, they get motivated. So they also feel, okay, I need to improve my learning. And then they try to actually do some kind of a research, discuss with the teachers, discuss with the fellow friends. And they come up with a lot of hard work and a lot of effort. So this kind of small, small bits and pieces, techniques of assessment, maybe at a summative or at a formative level, certainly help teachers and students equally to polish the learning process.
Thank you, Sabina ji. You have mentioned teachers, as all the speakers, I you know, agree with them. They have mentioned that teachers need a lot of planning. Teachers need to do this. Let's come to the students now, because we are all educators and we all agreed about, you know, activity-based learning that should be part of it. Subbalakshmi ji, I'd like to go to ask you what are the barriers that prevent student from investing time, energy and resources into the activities?
Okay, yeah. It's a relevant question for the current scenario, because it looks like children have the entire day with them, but still they don't have time, because there are a lot of other factors also, other barriers also, which hinder them in involving in an activity or something. But what we are taking now is time, energy and resources. When it comes to time, it looks like they have the whole day with them. What are you doing whole day? You're at home. But still, my day is not structured, because if I'm going to school, actually, I get up at a proper time, then I have my breakfast at certain time, my learning time is fixed, my lunch time is fixed, and everything is fixed. So my routine is proper. So I know when to do what. Now there is no set routine properly at home. So the kids, it looks like they have time, but they don't have proper time, or they are not able to prioritize their time. They're not able to structure their time. And if parents can help in this, and if teachers can guide the children how to structure their time, and definitely that will turn into a plus point than a barrier to them. So it is three, both of them have to work on, like the teacher, parent, and the child together need to be working on it and make sure the child understands. And then this when it comes to the time factor, most of the parents keep saying a lot of screen time, But most schools are having 2 hours in the morning at the maximum and other 2 hours in the afternoon, which is lesser than the school regular time. But they need to understand after the classes, no other screen time. So when they prioritize their time, structure the child's day, I'm sure that will not be a barrier for the child, and it will be helpful for the child to, you know, involve in the activity. The other one is the energy, you said, probably energy and enthusiasm and activeness and all that. So this is because, again, they're at home. So the day doesn't start at 6 o'clock for them. Most of them are getting up just before the online class. The class is starting at 9 o'clock. Okay, let me brush quickly, sit in front of the class. And there is no proper food timings. The food habits have changed. They're becoming lethargic. So the physical energy is not there. And the enthusiasm is also missing a little bit. Because anyway, I'm not going to show it directly to my teacher. And there is no direct involvement in the activity or something. So they are taking it light in that way. But if teachers can work on that area, and parents can work on that area, how structure the child's routine and proper food habits, and make sure the child is physically active also, then the child will be able to involve, and that may not turn into a barrier. The other reason is resources, you said. So the resources, it depends on whether it's a digital activity the child has to involve or a physical activity. If it comes to digital activity, the barriers are mainly, you know, a universal statement that every child is saying, ma'am, my internet is off. If the teacher is trying to ask a question, oh, she's asking question to that boy. Now this fellow will slowly turn off his camera, mute his mic, and ma'am, I can't see, I can't hear, I can't talk, internet issue. So it's like, if it's a digital activity, they are taking advantage of that, or it could be really happening also. So, and then the capability of the child using the digital system, digital device, and some families may not be able to provide two digital devices for both the children if they have two children at home. In general, everybody has two children at home. So the provision of the device and the capability of the digital learning and the digitally involving in the activity, these are the problems that could be. And if it is physical activity, like make a project or something, you know, the child can't go out and buy stuff or something, the chart paper, that thermocol, or that, you know, what we ask to make a project, suppose a volcano is asked to make or something. So these are all barriers, but definitely can be overcome, can be taken off, and then definitely we can motivate the children. For example, like we planned a science exhibition, like next week we are up to it. And so we told the children, okay, you decide your own engagement, what you want to do. But the main bottom line is use the resources that you have. So there are a lot of experiments that kids can do, a lot of learning that can happen within the resources that they have at home. So maybe if teachers can design such kind of engagements, which help the child to, you know, give the enough time and that motivate them physically to be active, and resources mainly which are available at home, either digitally or physically, what they have to do, then I think we can overcome this. Students can overcome, along with that, of course, they overcome, we overcome with that barrier of not able to do that activity or not able to involve that activity. And on top of it, make the learning engaging, challenging, and relevant, as I always say. So it has to be like relevant to the child so that he can even use the household equipment and work on it and do the best for best possibility is there. So that's what I feel, these are the areas. And definitely this is not a big barrier from teacher's side or parent's side. Child might feel it's a barrier, but easily can be taken over if we support the child with the discussion that we had just now.
Yes. Absolutely clear and
rightly mentioned, these are the barriers that can be overcome. But in our conversation throughout, it is the one thing that is there is motivation. Motivation is the driving factor which makes everything, you know, possible or overcoming the challenges. So for all the speakers, I have a common question, and I just want all the speakers to take quickly 60 seconds to answer this. And the question is, how are teachers motivating the students to be efficient during the crisis as students are getting gloomy and sad minds? I'll go with Aarti. Aarti, your perspective on this. Aarti? Okay, Bhavna, you're here? Aarti, you're here with us?
Yes.
Yes, please.
I think all the method that can be useful is like a hopeful and optimistic language of a teacher, making them aware that change is a part of life. I think all this kind of, even sometime like poster making, I knew like one of my teacher who used to paint in the class for explaining the things, and in turn he used to like call students onto the like board, like just paint it what you have learned from the section. So in that way, I think if you're boosting the morale, even if you're working online, calling the name of the child itself is a good booster. The way you called my name, so immediately I responded yes, like someone is calling me. So that attention grabs your inspiration. So I think in that way we can do that.
That's absolutely nice. Bhavna, I like you to answer on that also.
Yes, we have talked a lot about on this, but I will add one more thing. We are very much hesitant in appreciating a child. We often see this, teachers also feel ki every time we have to appreciate. Yes, we have to appreciate whatever child do during the class. Yes, ma'am, very much ma'am said, Subbalakshmi ma'am, ki we should develop a way how to check the child, how to tell the child that you are right or wrong. If he is saying something wrong also, then also tell him in a polite way. And every time appreciating is required. Once you appreciated by anybody, you also feel very good and you have that motivation to do more and more. In the same way, students also feel very good. Appreciation is must.
Okay, the key is appreciation for you. And with that, I'll go to Naina and I'll ask her same question.
Unmute.
Please unmute, Naina. You're on mute.
Yeah. I'm sorry. Yeah. So I said, along with the technical skills, if we encourage them with the soft skills through the supplementary activities with the students, then they will stop acting, gloomy. And moreover, engage them in life skills. As I always say, am I audible?
Yes.
As I always say that life skills should be one of the lessons taught in all the schools, where we learn to sew, teach them how to sew, how to change the tires, about the banks, about all the basic things. You know, these basic things, even if we want to teach them even germination or photosynthesis or whatever, these all the things, banking, this pandemic has taught us when we were at home. So we can pass it on to the students. They will not even understand that we are teaching them. So as parents, we all are parents also first. I guess rather than setting them a very big targets and big goals, our aim should be to make them happy and satisfied. And that will happen when that smile will come, when we allow them to do what they want. And I don't think then they will be sad anymore. So this is it.
Absolutely. Life skills. And I think everybody talks about, you know, good jobs, good career. And if they start talking about being happy, I think the problem will be solved. As an educator also, we should talk about being happy.
So with that,
I'd like to move to Sabina ji.
Yeah. Thank you, Kavita. I completely agree with all my fellow panelists that, you know, apart from this, we had recently organized Zoom lunch so that you know, class-wise teachers that organize Zoom lunch. We also insist that they celebrate all the festivals and ceremonies and, you know, like birthday celebration together. So maybe a teacher can be a part of it, but she can at least, you know, like move that ahead by involving all the students and maybe in a group with the prior permission of the parents. Certainly all the stakeholders are in the loop. And if they all agree, we can, you know, in bits and pieces, we can organize such kind of activities. And we also have one system in our school where the students share on every day or every alternate day, happy moments of that particular day. So they get the opportunity to share the happy moments. And then when they share their moments, certainly the environment becomes so enabling that students all are in the cheerful mood. And you know, as you rightly said, that we need to make them happy. Apart from teaching curriculum, which is nowadays, I feel it's a secondary thing. The prior thing is they need to be happy. And if the teacher herself is motivated and inspired, so we need to pep the teachers. The leaders also need to take, teacher is also going through this kind of a difficult phase. So it is vertically flowing. So if you are keeping the teachers motivated, in turn, the students are motivated. And it is very well said, students' motivation leads to teacher motivation. So this ceremony goes on very harmoniously and everyone gets, you know, that kind of outcome of happiness.
Yes, definitely. We all need to be, you know, excited because energy and happiness is contagious. Mm-hmm. So we need, as a teacher, as an educator, we all need to be, you know, at that energy level and, you know, being happy ourselves. Mm-hmm. So I like to Subbalakshmi ji for her, you know, views.
Yeah. As I said earlier, they're missing the school ambience. So I'll context my own school because we are giving absolutely the school ambience virtually. So they have all the classes, the music class, dance class, art class, sports classes. We have 10 varieties of sports, archery and, you know, fencing and whatnot and all. So they have all those classes. The teachers are doing, I mean, I was amazed. Initially, we were like, how can it happen? But, you know, we kickstarted it and it is a wonderful thing. So later we took a survey like, okay, not enough time for academics. So should we forego these sports classes? All parents said, yes, forego. All students said, no, we want the sports in place, activities in place, the dance class in place. So that is really one thing that is making them come out of that sadness or the gloominess. And as Sabina mentioned, we are also having that common lunch every fortnight, twice in a month. The class teacher and the children sit together in the lunchtime and they crack jokes and all. And the class teacher tries to leave the class for some time. And then so the children can spend their own personal time. You know, they want some time without the teacher because they're missing that cracking jokes and then the talking, hey, you re, my re, she re and all that, you know, they're missing that. So the teacher leaves them for some time in the lunchroom. Okay, now you all talk for some time and then we can get back to another class. So these are the things. And then assembly, we have, you know, monthly once the assembly. And then we have all other events which are happening, like started with the Father's Day in the beginning of the academic year. Everything, the Ganesh Puja celebration, Children's Day went on wonderfully and all the children, because that is one of the, as it is, school life is one of the best thing in their life, in everyone's life. And in the school days, Children's Day and birthday celebration, these two are the best thing that children love to have it. So we celebrated the Children's Day so well and kids were so happy and they celebrated Teacher's Day for us with, you know, those dramas and dances and everything they self-organized and they did, because now every child is digitally quite tech savvy and then they are able to do it. So we are trying to bring, not only we, I mean, I quoted this example, but I think everyone, if they, because the main thing is they're missing that school, they're missing that ambience, they're missing that friends. So if we can bring that into place along with learning, okay, learning, teach this way, teach that way, do that, do this, all this we have to do, but I'm missing that plate. So that if that plate of that ambience or that school structure can be given to the children, so they need that little bit of that freedom, that space, that time, I think then definitely they will come out of that gloominess and sadness and they'll be very active in the next class and happy to be there. So we are just having the sports day in the next month. We almost planned for it. So it's like everything is as per the calendar. So I think absolutely, this is one thing what we feel. Yeah.
Absolutely beautiful. Listen to all of you, because the kind of experience, I think here we have over 100 years of experience together. and the insight that is being brought to us. And that reminds me of a quote which says, you know, we are not thinking machines, we are feeling machines that think. And that connection, that motivation with the learning need to be continued. And that's, I feel, the whole the agenda of that connection, motivation that serves here. And it was amazing to listen to all of you. And we are moving to the next session of it, Myth and Facts, a rapid fire session taken by Sunanda Rao. Sunanda Rao, she is, as you all know, she is a managing editor, Career Beacon. She is a founder, concept, career guidance. And she is also a convener for National Career Counselors Network. She is passionate about, you know, helping the youth with her corporate experience of over 17 years in the HR. She has also certified into various psychometric tools. And with that, she's been able to create the impact over thousands of students. And that's why she has been given an award, Indian Icon Award, for her contribution towards, you know, impacting the youth through career guidance activities. With that, I'd like to welcome Sunanda. And I request her to take this rapid fire myths and facts, most exciting part of this series. Over to you, Sunanda.
Thank you so much. Welcome all the viewers, welcome all the speakers for this series. And believe me, I was jotting down each and every point, whatever you were saying. Not because, you know, I wanted to point it out, because yes, of course, this is, as I said, I'm very passionate about something. This is my passion coming into, this is going to get all these pointers, what the teachers have said. As I've mentioned in the YouTube, I'm coming up with a quiz question. Now, all the viewers who have been attentive, there was a teacher who mentioned that she is playing a role play of Sholay. You will have to name that teacher, that who has done that. And believe me, during the myths and facts round, I am going to come up with each question of the quiz, and I'll be evaluating all the YouTube chats later on. Believe me, everyone who is going to answer correctly, right? And I'll take only first three, because rest everyone will cut, copy and paste. So I will take first three people, and they will actually win something really good, and you will be excited to take that gift along with you. Now, with this, let me come to the rapid fire round, that is myths and facts, because this is the USP of this series. Now, in this myths and facts, I'm going to put forward one statement. Every speaker is supposed to say whether it's a myth or a reality, and you have to actually support it with the statement. If it is a reality, why it is a reality? Why, if it is a myth, why it is a myth, and why are you debunking it? And I am not going in the traditional way of going alphabetically. I'll go in the reverse order, because myself is, you know, my name starts with S. So I come in the end of the session. So let me ask that with Subbalakshmi ji. Teachers are responsible for a whole child wholesome education. Is it a myth or a reality?
It is definitely a myth. It is not just the teacher who is responsible for the child's complete learning. It's a triangle process where the parent, the school and the child, three of them together work. And if parents feel that, okay, I paid the fees and it's not enough. And if the teacher feels like I taught it, it's not enough. And if the child feels like, okay, I attended the school 100% days, it's not enough. So it is totally a myth that teachers only have to take care of it. It is a triangle process that parents, the school, entire school and the child have to be involved in the process of learning, and then only it will be a proper learning that happens.
Perfect. So first statement was a myth, and triangle, you know, all the three stakeholders are required to be a part of this, you know, entire education system. So now with this, let me come to Sabina. Sabina, the question is, teachers never take students' behavior or attitude personally. Is it a myth or a reality?
No, it's a reality. I am sure everyone will agree, and even all the viewers will agree, because teachers never take personally. The teachers who are really passionate, who are really, you know, like a reflective teacher, they certainly, you know, like they try to explain the child in case if the behavior is not appropriate sometime, or maybe they are hurt with that behavior. They will certainly take all the stakeholders in the loop. They will try to modify the behavior, and certainly pretty much into affective domain also. So they will utilize that full affective domain that even utilizing the resource team, all the educators, the counselors, and she will ensure, a teacher will ensure that, you know, the child may need to be guided properly, thoroughly, in the, and it needs to be monitored. And the they will also ensure that, you know, if the outcome has actually come where the child has improvised the behavior. Sometimes, you know, like we generally try to imitate our teachers, the walking style, speaking style, the way the teachers teach. So sometimes teachers get affected by it, but teachers don't take that personally. It is not affected at all. So it's a complete myth.
Very well said, Sabina ji. So teachers do not take the things, you know, personally. They take it holistically to improvise the student. With this, let me come to the next question of the quiz to all the viewers. In fact, if the speakers would also like to answer, there was one speaker who said that students are actually missing the ambience of the school and they are missing that Tom and Jerry fights. You need to name me that who was the teacher, who was the speaker who spoke during the session about the same. You will have to give me either the initials, either you can give me the first name or the second name. Should be, you know, recommended for the award. But again, only three people would be recommended. Well, with this, let me come to Naina ji. So down, you know, from South, I went to Mumbai to now going to Bhind, Madhya Pradesh. So here, fear is the great way to inspire motivation. Is it a myth or a reality?
Well, for Indians, it is a reality. Because you know how stubborn okay. we are with certain things. So we if we have that fear factor, then only we do certain things. Otherwise, we are laid off people. And yes, I am a Mumbaikar, a proud Mumbaikar. All Mumbai is watching me today. Now I have come to Bhind. So yes, I'm part of here. Otherwise, they'll kick me out. So yes, I will say wherever I go in any part of the globe. But yes, for an Indian, wherever he goes, until and unless he has any fear, he won't do that activity. Like if you take an example, the people who are staying near the sea, coastal areas, first they will do is they will push their kids in the well. Why? They have to swim. They have to learn swimming because why the fear of drowning? So this is what the mentality is mostly. Otherwise, we in city areas, we will only push our kids for swimming because they have to learn that. But otherwise, compulsorily, you go into the interior villages, everyone knows swimming. So this is fear. You take the example of pandemic, the day-to-day example. Everybody had that fear factor. So you could see those masks coming into the scene and so many other things. So until and unless, if we don't have fear, we have the fear of competition. We have the fear of failure. We have the fear of failing relationships. So we work on them. Until and unless we don't have fear, then we will not work on anything. So I think we will take it positively. It is a reality, but fear has to be a guiding force to complete the reality, to complete whatever target we have in our hand, then we will be successful anyhow. So I guess I have answered you.
Thank you so much, Naina ji. Let me go to Bhavna. So from Madhya Pradesh, let me go to Delhi now. And let me ask her, write down your goals and success is guaranteed. Is it a myth or a reality?
I totally disagree. It's a myth only. I would rather say target on your goals and success is guaranteed. Once you set the goal, then work hard on it. And with passion and zeal, success is confirmed. For example, if a child wants to become a successful football player, now jotting down the points as a knowledge, it's good. But if you are not going to the ground to practice it, you cannot achieve a good football player. So on my point, target all your goals, success is guaranteed. That's it.
Okay. With this, I'm getting the answers on the YouTube. Thank you so much for all the viewers who are writing it. Now, some speakers said, you know, relationship is nothing, but it's a love that has to be done, the bond of love. So you need to tell me who was the speaker who spoke about it. And believe me, if you are taking my clues, I am giving the clues in a manner how the alphabetically or non-alphabetically the things are going. So you are smart enough, you can crack it. With this, let me come to Aarti Dua from Gujarat. She has to answer me on this particular statement. Good motivation strategies and practices will work for students or teacher. Is it a myth or a reality?
120% fact. Inspiration is an important life skill. Motivation is an urge to believe or act in a way that will satisfy certain conditions such as wishes, desires, goals. The reason it's important is because every person on this earth is unique and has a purpose. To steward your purpose well, you have to be motivated to work towards your goal, which helps your dreams become a reality. Psychologists even believe the motivation is rooted in a basic impulse to optimize well-being, minimize physical pain, and even maximize pleasure. So motivation are commonly separated. You will say it is a biological and motive that guide you. It's a fact. In addition to it, even motivations can be intrinsic or extrinsic. In reality, our motivations are often a mix of both factors, and the nature of the mix can definitely change over time. So I'm the person, except my blood group, 120%, I'm the motivated person and a positive person. So it's a fact.
Very well said. And with this, there is a question for the audience, for the viewers. The question is very clear. Some speakers said, optimistic words are actually an encouragement. You'll have to name that speaker who has said this statement. And with this, let me go to the second leg of the myths and facts, and let me come to again to Subbalakshmi ma'am. This is said that visualize success and universe will give the success. Believe me, I am a firm believer of law of attraction, but still, I would like to know your perspective on this, whether it's a myth or a reality.
Yes, Sunanda, it's a bit of perspective statement, but for me, it's a myth. Because if I just visualize the success, it doesn't come to me. I have to work on it, as the earlier speaker said. Like, it doesn't just come by visualizing. It needs a proper planning. It needs to think about the roadblocks. It needs to think about the risk factors. It needs to think about the possibilities. So if I work on all those things, and if I plan and implement, then if my visualization is coming into a plan and implementation, then the universe gives me success. But otherwise, it is not just a success like that. And one more thing I would like to point out is success is not the ultimate end. So in the process that I go through, I face a lot of roadblocks. I went through a lot of risk factors. I overcome the risk factors and I worked on it. So even though I fail at the end, there is something that learning is happening. But as a statement, I would say it is a bit of myth for me.
Okay, that so this brings me to the next question to all the viewers. Some speakers said that, you know, they organize Zoom lunch, Zoom festivals, wherein teachers are a part of that so that they can be the part of celebration. You need to name that speaker, or the first name or the second name. You can give me the initials also, but again, first three people will be getting the award. With this, let me come to another speaker on the myths and facts. The question is, Sabina ji, the greater rewards will lead to greater motivation. Is it a myth or a fact?
It's a myth. It's a complete myth, actually. I firmly believe that, you know, your rewards and your motivation and your inspiration and your, you know, like it's a part of it. It may be to some extent when a child is very young, for example, and you give some kind of rewards, some kind of, you know, like motivation to a child to attend that particular school, because the child doesn't know. The child is not at that stage to understand that why the school is important for me. But the basic rewards, and actually it's from within. It's your own battle. You know, I believe it's your own battle. You have to fight it out. How long are people going to motivate you? Maybe at times in your life, there are teachers who will motivate you. Parents will motivate you, but a time will come when there will be no one at times. So you have to give that positive strokes to your own self. And if you believe in yourself, if you trust yourself, so initially it's fine, but later on, only your own within, your intrinsic support, your esoteric only will be, you know, in action. So that is a complete myth. Your inner part is the more important and self booster, and that positive strokes, every individual, if they want to grow and they want to develop in their life, they need to take up in a very hard-hold manner that they give that kind of energy to themselves.
Thank you so much, Sabina ji. So viewers, you need your own self spark which will ignite your self motivation. You cannot have an external body always to keep a motivation. This is what this Sabina has said. With this, let me go to Naina ji. Naina ji, you should praise the talent instead of efforts. Is it a myth or a reality? You'll have to unmute yourself.
Yeah. Yeah, well, according to me,
you asked me whether talent needs combination.
Talent.
Combination of effort. Yeah, I will tell you. Talent needs combination of efforts. Because I'll give you an example. Talent anybody can have. Okay. Everybody feels I'm talented. But until and unless you put the correct and the right efforts, then you won't be successful. So if I give you a live example of our god of cricket, Mr. Sachin Tendulkar, then well, if I'll give you one small example that after the cricket match and they would have some, you know, simple dinners or parties, but if he has a match next day, then you would find him in the pitch working on his drive, working on his pitch and cricket and his strokes. Why? He knew he had talent, but he was putting his efforts. So according to me, that talent, if you don't have, it is fine. But if you put the efforts, if you focus on your negatives, if you focus on the plus points, you can work. And with this, if you focus on these negatives, if you put the efforts, definitely you can groom yourself. So for me, it's a combination, and for me, it is a myth. You cannot actually say that, you know, either way. So according to me, you have to be all-rounders, but for all-rounders, you have to put yourself into those grilling times, and that is called as best thing is to work hard on this. So I guess it has to be a combination of efforts.
Very great insights. Yes, efforts have to be put no matter how talented you are. The practice is required and you need to strategize on that. With this, let me go to Bhavna. Bhavna, before I go to you, there is a one question for all the viewers. Someone said that, you know, happy moments of a day is something that is their school practice. So all the viewers who are watching us, you need to let me know that who was the speaker who spoke about this happy moments. And you can answer it. The first three people will be awarded. Again, coming back to Bhavna. Bhavna, your question is, you'll have to wait for the right motivation to strike. Is it a myth or a reality?
It's a myth. I will totally say it's a myth. Motivation means to desire to do something. Motivation actually means this. Also, if you want success, you just try. Once you are trying, you will achieve the success. So try process should be there. I will quote a very common example of a real hero. If we talk about the Edison, we all know about the Edison. He did near about 2000 plus experiments to invent a bulb. Every experiment gave him a motivation, every experiment to do something next. So if we think on this perspective, yes, we have to try. Try only can make us try. So every motivation
will set down.
Yes.
Yeah, very well said. In fact, we have to learn it from the nature. A snake gives so many eggs and seldom one or two eggs get survived. Similarly, there are examples where the things happen and they actually, you know, fail multiple times, but only one or two species are actually, you know, making a successful entry to the world. So that brings to the last myth of the day to Aarti. Aarti, this is actually already spoken during the question answers, but I would like you to reiterate because most of the viewers are the teachers, parents, and the students who are watching. Writing down your goals is the key to success. Is it a myth or a reality?
I think it's a fact, not maybe in India, but as a human, it is a fact. It is not general recall that improves when you're writing, when you write things down. Writing it down will also improve your recall of really important information. It just helps you remember. It makes your mind more efficient by helping you focus on the truly important stuff. And your goals absolutely qualify. Otherwise, imagine like sitting out on a trip with no say particular destination in mind. How do you pack yourself? What road do you take? How do you know where you have to go and where you have to reach? Instead, you start by picking a destination. It is as same as your career goal and your for your life and for everywhere. If you have just jotted down somewhere. Once it is jotted down on your mind. So once you recall, it recalls just like that. Otherwise, you have to keep on scrolling the mind.
So one key or one summary that I can get it from all the myths and the facts is action is very much required and you need to plan it in a proper way. May it be Naina, how she said that, you know, Sachin. That, you know, action is required before that. Once you have returned, it doesn't mean that it has to be done. Obviously, it has to be backed up by the action. With this, let me conclude today's session before we go to the felicitation process. And here, before Kavita comes with the felicitation thing, I would like all the speakers to conclude their session remarks right now so that Kavita prepares herself with the felicitation thing. So let me go in a reverse manner with Subbalakshmi, then I'll come to Aarti Dwapar.
Yeah, I would say this is a wonderful session and very, very productive and, the relevant topic for the situation now that's going on. And you all made it with a very thoughtful ideas and then the process that you went through either before the webinar or during the webinar is really commendable and it is really amazing. Thank you so much for involving us.
Thank you so much, Subbalakshmi ji. Let me go to Sabina Keshwani. Your concluding remarks on the session, on the entire episode or whatever you would like to say, even if you would like to conclude everything, whatever you said in a very nectar manner, so you can actually express yourself.
I would like to just share about educationist Rabindranath Tagore. He said the main objective of teaching is not to give explanations, but to knock at the door of the minds. So child is everything for a teacher. So if a teacher prepares, practices and performs along with perseverance, accompanying with the yardstick of knocking at the door of minds, that is by building consciousness and awareness, showing every downfall and crisis as an opportunity, the entire process of teaching and learning, student engagement becomes a joyful contribution. And that's what actually the basic crux is, you know, we all need to be in action. And a lot of hard work, if it is being put by the educator, certainly it shows and the engagement certainly happens.
Thank you so much, Sabina ji, for quoting what Dr. Rabindranath Tagore has said. And what is the meaning of real education for the educators? With this, let me come to Naina ji. Naina ji, your concluding remarks on today's show.
Well, my concluding remarks will be, I have met beautiful friends today. I have engaged myself with one new family. And my concluding lines will be, my dear friends, education will define you. How you project will lead you to your element. And with this concluding, I will just say one poem which was written by, I can only imagine to see what a child can see. To see what your eyes see, you must give them a chance. To see what a child's eyes see, you must give them voice. We can only imagine what a child will see. As educators, we must open our eyes to use theirs. And if we can't see, we must listen and try to imagine. And this is what my message written by me to everyone, that just try to listen to all the cute future generation. And this is the takeaway for me from this session. I have generated everything, all the points I've summed up from all my fellow friends. Thank you so much. And
thank
it was really
wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much, because you gave an empathetic point of view, because when Subbalakshmi said that, you know, students are missing it, when, you know, Aarti said optimism is something that is required. Bhavna said, you know, role model, role playing is something that is required. Keshwani, you know, Sabina Keshwani said that, you know, happy moments, and you yourself said life skills. So these are the things which are the real pointers. Let me come to Bhavna. Bhavna, your concluding remarks on the show for today.
I will take to another cut to it. I would say ki this pandemic is something negative. And every time we are talking about negative, negative and negative, why don't we see the pandemic positive part? We have to see. As a teacher, we need to take out the positivity. rather than negativity. This pandemic has turned us a multitasker. I would say everybody is a multitasker now. This is a very positive side. I have seen students, those who are shy, those who even don't speak a single word in the class, but on the screen, they are exploring themselves. So we should teach them the positivity rather than teaching them the negativity. If we are teaching them positivity, yes, the class will be interesting. Everything, happiness will be there. Then there will be no sadness, no gloominess. Why don't we say this corona? Why don't we turn this corona as corona? It should be a compassion. Make this corona.
Wow.
And turn it to a compassion.
Wow.
I don't have a words. I'm feeling honored to be on this panel. I have heard everybody. You all are seniors to me. Really, thank you. Thank you, Career Beacon, to giving me this platform. Positivity, happiness is a main mantra we can take from this platform. Thank you. Thank you, Career Beacon.
Wow, such a beautiful message, Bhavna. Such a beautiful message, Bhavna, that positivity is the key. We should take everything with a positive thing. Now, Aarti, you will have to summarize the entire session because everyone has said their bit and you have to give the words of optimism to sugarcoat it.
Actually, yes. Yes, in these times of sitting behind the camera or pause and uncertainty, it is of paramount importance to remain calm, practice empathy and find a way for this crisis to affect our day-to-day life as little as possible. See, it is essential to reduce anxiety levels and focus on what is paramount, namely our health. Hope is the motivation and that empowers enabling to get out of bed every single day in the morning. So remember, I want to quote a Hindi the sentence, Lakshya ke bina jeevan us लेटर की तरह है जिसके ऊपर कोई एड्रेस नहीं होता और जो अपने मुकाम पर कभी नहीं पहुंचता. सो योर लिमिटेशन इज द ओनली योर इमेजिनेशन. बी देयर, बी मोटिवेटेड एवरी डे, इवन राइट फ्रॉम लाइक एयर टू लाइक एनिमल टू योर पड़ोसी टू योर फ्रेंड्स एंड रिलेटिव्स, एवरीवन, यू विल फाइंड मोटिवेशन एवरीवेयर.
वाओ, दैट्स रियली गुड. Listening to somebody who said sky is the limit is a myth because there is no sky. Aap yahan se dharti se moon pe jab ja rahe hoge, aap bologe nahi, I am passing through the sky. So there is no sky. It's an unlimited thing. Abundance is all around. And as Bhavna has said, everything has to be positive. So everyone wrapped up so beautifully. Now, Kavita, please come up with your, you know, happy moments that you have captured, the learning that we had, and the felicitation process.
Thank you, Sunanda. It was really, really, mesmerizing to be with such beautiful speakers and the thoughts, the inside perspective that each and everyone has shared. And this is the moment we have captured with all of us together. And moving to our speakers, our first speaker, Mrs. Aarti Dua, and it's a small token of appreciation from our side, a small token of love. It's always a pleasure to have you. And thank you for sharing your insight. With us, we had Ms. Bhavna Chadda, and it was absolutely, beautiful to hear you. Corona is Corona. So that's so beautifully said.
Corona is ma'am, turn Corona into Karuna. Karuna,
right.
The compassion.
Okay. Karuna. That's a Hindi word. Okay. That's beautiful. Bhavna, thank you for being with us. It's a small token of our love and appreciation for being here with us.
Thank you.
So we have our beautiful speaker, ever smiling, Ms. Naina Chaure, and it was absolutely amazing to have you. And thank you for sharing your insight. Small token of appreciation and love from our side.
Much gratitude from Bhind family, from Mount Literacy School Bhind family. Thank you so much, Career Beacon. Thank you so much.
Our pleasure too. So we have beautiful Miss Sabina Keswani with us. And it was a happy moment for us. for being with you. So Sabina ji, it's a small token of love and appreciation for you for being with us.
Thank you so much to thank you so much Kavita ji, thank you Kavya Dikan, thank you everyone, each and everyone, thank you Sunanda ji, thank you,
our pleasure. So from south we have Mrs. Suha Lakshmi Bulsu, and with her we had great I would say she shared the thoughts of the students, which the students think, it was absolutely amazing having her with us. It's a small token of love and appreciation for her being with us and sharing her insight and experience that she brings with her. Thank you, ma'am.
And everyone is eminent here, and really wonderful to be in touch with you all, and let's keep connecting. That's wonderful. Thank you so much.
Definitely. It was a beautiful, happy moment for us also. And it was your presence is also motivating us to continue bringing these kind of series. With that, I'll invite Sunanda to conclude the entire session.
Thank you so much, Kavita, for felicitating the speakers, because what they have done, a sincere gratitude to everyone, because you have added a really good pointers to this show. Now, with this, let me announce who were the winners. Madhubala, Ruchika Yadav, then we have Nandini Kumari, then we have again Ruchika Yadav, Bhushan Kumar, Priyanka Modi, Swati Sharma, Shreyansh Jain, and yeah, these are the people who are the winners. So those who, if your viewers are viewing us, you are requested to please connect with us, on our email ID or on our social media accounts, so that we can actually deliver the gift for you or the...
Unmute, Sunanda.
Because this is something that we are actually looking forward for. And we will be coming back with another beautiful episode next week. And all the speakers, we are going to stay connected with you, because we are creating an elite club of Career Beacon, wherein one of you would be a part of it. We are because of you, so we cannot leave you guys. So with this, we sign off from today's episode. This is me and Kavita signing off. Very well moderated show, Kavita, and beautiful speakers have brought the beautiful pointers, which can be actually seen on Career Beacon site very shortly as a part of a blog. With this, thank you so much. Stay healthy.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everybody.
Thank you,
Kavita. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Kavita ma'am.
Thank you.
It's thank you, all the panelists. Thank you.
And all the panelists also.
Thank you. Thank you so much.